This apple was designed and created to be the best. It's a feat of science and economics, patience and ingenuity, all culminating in this one remarkable fruit, the Honeycrisp. To understand what makes Honeycrisp so appealing, you have to go to the cellular level. The cells of the Honeycrisp are much larger than other apples, meaning they have larger sugar-filled pockets of water called vacuoles. As apples ripen, they produce enzymes which alter the pectins that glue the cell walls together, reducing the adhesion between cells. Apples like the Honeycrisp retain the strong bonds between cells even as they ripen, so when you bite into it, the cells burst open, releasing the juices inside. In apples like the Red Delicious, the enzymes are able to break down the bonds, so your teeth just cleave off the cells at the cell walls, giving you that unpleasant, mealy texture. So, how did we get from here to here? Back in the 1800s, there were upwards of 14,000 unique varieties of apples in the United States. Apples like the Streaked Pippin, Boy's Delight, the Babbitt, and the Ladyfinger, an overabundance of apple varieties all unique in size, color, and taste. But 100 years later, most of them have been forgotten. The birth of industrial agriculture sent refrigerated trains crisscrossing America, delivering a bulk supply of apples to supermarkets across the country. Apples had to last longer, and in order to sell, look prettier. So the apple industry settled on perfecting the look of just a handful of varieties at the expense of their taste. This cosmetic breeding meant a pretty, shiny apple with a tough and bitter skin. This is where the hero of our story enters, David Bedford, an apple breeder from the University of Minnesota. Tired of the Red Delicious's reign atop the produce aisle, he was determined to find something better. And he did, after taking a bite from an apple off a tree that was marked to be cut down. This was the very beginning of the Honeycrisp apple. He spent the next 30 years cultivating that apple, finally introducing it to the marketplace in 1991. But why did this take 3 decades? An apple is basically a womb of the mother tree. Inside are its offspring, and like humans, each individual seed is a little different. If a seed grows into a tree, its apples will not be identical to its siblings, which is a problem when you're trying to create a product that should look and taste the same every time you eat it. So, in order to produce identical apples, trees must be cloned. A tree is cloned by grafting a shoot from the original tree onto a living root, and then sold to farmers. This means every Macintosh apple you've eaten is a clone from the original tree discovered in 1811. Apple trees can take up to 10 years to produce fruit, so the selective breeding process is very slow. Since its release in 1991, the Honeycrisp has taken off. It's now the 5th most purchased apple variety and the fastest growing in popularity. But there's another important point to make here. This lack of biodiversity is dangerous for crops. Since the commercialization of the apple in the past century, we may have lost 80% of traditional apple varieties. The identical genetic code of most of America's apples means a single disease could wipe out huge portions. The Irish potato famine was caused when a bad fungus was able to spread through the country because all the potatoes were genetically identical. So, beyond being crisp, juicy, and delicious, Honeycrisps are heralded because they show that apple diversity could be marketable. Basically, because of the popularity of Honeycrisps, more breeders are making more varieties of apples to try to dethrone the new king. Apple growers and eaters are lining up to get a taste of new varieties like Cosmic Crisp, Sweet Tango, Rave, and Juicy, returning us closer to our rich history of apples. Thanks, Honeycrisp.